The history of math is our intellectual foundation to understanding science. Science. Beautiful, awesome, wonderful science. It's the creative foundation to our ineffable future. Hi, I'm Gabrielle Burchak, and this is my podcast, Math, Science, History. This podcast is sustained through your generous contributions, which I am so very grateful for. You can visit me at mathsciencehistory.com. Click on that coffee cup on the right side of my website and buy me a cup of coffee, or two, or three, or four, because every cup of coffee that you buy keeps this podcast up and running. Many of us would not be alive today if it were not for the altruistic work of all of our healthcare workers. This February, my podcast is a special tribute to Black History Month, to love, to African American men and women, and to all of those who have worked tirelessly on the front lines fighting the deadly disease that is coronavirus. You are our heroes, our sheroes, our rock, our strength, and everything that we needed this year. Thank you. It was my intention to do a podcast about one of the earliest Black women in medicine. However, our history appears to be void of the valuable African-American lives that have made a difference in science today. Furthermore, our history is void of the African-American relationships that move our hearts and inspire us to let love guide us through difficult times. This next story has remained hidden for over a century. It is one of the most awe-inspiring, heart-moving stories that I have researched in quite a while. In 1864, Rebecca Davis Lee Crumpler became the very first African-American woman to become a medical doctor in the United States, and possibly the world. Rebecca was born on February 8, 1831, in Delaware. However, she grew up in Pennsylvania and was raised by an aunt who took care of sick townspeople. Watching her aunt take care of others inspired Rebecca to become a nurse. In 1852, at the age of 21, Rebecca moved to Charlestown, Massachusetts. There she studied at West Newton English and Classical School. While attending school, she worked tirelessly as a nurse. The 1895 edition of the Illustrated Biographical Catalog of the Principals, Teachers, and Students of the West Newton English and Classical School described Rebecca as, quote, a special student in mathematics, unquote. In other words, Rebecca was brilliant. On April 19, 1852, Rebecca married Wyatt Lee, a former slave and formerly married. Wyatt had a 6-year-old son named Albert, who also became part of the family. And so Rebecca attended school and helped raise their son. Sadly, a year after their marriage, Albert died at the age of 7. While working as a nurse, several of the physicians she worked with encouraged and urged her to apply to a new, groundbreaking medical school called the New England Female Medical College. At their urging, Rebecca, empowered with several letters of recommendation from the doctors she worked with, applied and was accepted into the medical college in 1860. This medical college was groundbreaking because it was a new medical college that trained and taught only women. This is significant considering in 1860, there were only 54,000 doctors in the United States, and only 300 of them were women. Among those women, Rebecca was the only African-American student. Her first year was very successful. However, the following year, she had to relocate to Richmond, Virginia for a year. This was 1861 and the beginning of the Civil War. Medical workers were needed, and she was ready to serve. However, after that first year, when she moved back to Boston, the school had withdrawn her scholarship. This did not stop her. She applied for the Benjamin Wade Scholarship and won. This helped her to fund the rest of her studies. Unfortunately, after her second year back at the medical college, she encountered another obstacle. On April 18, 1863, her husband Wyatt died from tuberculosis. However, Rebecca persevered. On February 24, 1864, after 3 years of education, writing her thesis and paying her dues, Rebecca, along with two of her white classmates, Mary Lockwood Allen and Elizabeth Kimball, stood before the faculty and carried out their final examinations. She had shown the medical college and the medical community that she was a resilient woman who truly wanted to commit her life to the medical industry. After her oral presentation, the faculty then recommended Rebecca and the other two students to the Board of Trustees. However, some of the faculty had reservations about recommending Rebecca's thesis to the board. They noted that she had deficiencies in her education and indicated, quote, "Some of us have hesitated very seriously in recommending her," unquote. Possibly some of the previous physicians that she had worked with in Charlestown had reached out to the trustees of the medical school and had put pressure on the school's faculty to award her with a medical degree. Because on March 1st, 1864, Rebecca conferred. She earned her medical degree, which noted that, quote, "Mrs. Rebecca Lee Negress," unquote, was now a doctress of medicine. According to statistics, at this time, only 35% of the women who attended this medical school completed the program and received a medical degree. These statistics highlight Rebecca's capabilities, fortitude, resilience, and brilliance. Her hard work paid off. Rebecca was the very first Black woman in the United States and possibly the world to receive a medical degree. Meanwhile, another story was unfolding. Let's go back a few decades to 1835, when a female slave gave birth to a little boy named Arthur. Arthur's mother was a slave on the Robert Adams estate in Southampton County, Virginia, now known as Cortland, Virginia. Arthur's biological father, Samuel, was also a slave, but on a neighboring property owned by Benjamin Crumpler. Thus, Arthur took the last name of Crumpler. When Arthur was 9 years old, his master, Robert Adams, died unexpectedly. As a result, Robert Adams' property had to be distributed among his family. This, quote, property included his slaves. However, Arthur liked living on the Adams estate, and he knew that a different slave owner would treat him poorly. He did not want to leave. As a result, he approached Robert Adams' oldest son, John, and told him, quote, "John, I can wrestle you down," unquote. John Adams was a grown man. This 9-year-old boy was taunting him and he could not believe it, so he took him on. However, Arthur managed to wrestle and pin down John Adams. As a result, John Adams came to appreciate this young man. So, when all the slaves were sold in the estate sale, John decided to have Arthur stay with him on the estate. Around 1844 or 1845, Adams took Arthur with him to Smithfield, Virginia. They stayed there for a year. Adams thought it would profit him to loan out Arthur to other slave owners. As a result, Arthur became a slave of another owner for about 4 years, but then was returned back to John. At this time, John had married. His wife's parents needed help on their property, so John loaned Arthur out to them. While working on the property of John's in-laws, Arthur worked at harvesting and processing the apples. He was a smart man. While processing the apples, Arthur realized that he could improve the apple paring machine to expedite the work. One day, John came by his in-laws' property and met up with Arthur, who showed him what he did with the mechanism to speed up the processing of the apples. John was so impressed that he decided to take Arthur back to his property. There are multiple reasons why Adams did this. Possibly, there was no patent for this mechanism and John wanted to profit off of it. Perhaps he realized the value in having Arthur on his property and realized that he could make money from Arthur's intelligence and skills. And so he took Arthur back to work on his own property. Back on John's property, John presented Arthur with the opportunity to learn a trade of his choice. Arthur wanted to learn blacksmithing. As a result, with the skill, Arthur earned approximately $250 per year, but more than likely, John pocketed the money. By 1858, slavery had been abolished in 17 states, and for the states that had not formed yet in the northern Midwest to the western coast, these were free territories. The African Americans in the slave states knew that they had rights, and they knew that they could live a better life. John knew this as well as he watched his own slaves run away from his estate. His estate was in Virginia, which bordered on the free northern states. As a result, to keep Arthur from running away, John John set up Arthur with his own blacksmithing shop on the property. Then, on April 12, 1861, Confederate General Beauregard bombarded Fort Sumter, which started the Civil War. During the chaos, many slaves, including Arthur, saw their opportunity and ran from their masters to escape slavery. Many went straight to the Norfolk Navy Yard, where they took refuge on the USS Cumberland. After they embarked, the boat sailed to Fort Monroe, where Arthur took work as a blacksmith making horseshoes. His skill set was recognized and appreciated so much that eventually he went on to work for the Union, specifically General McClellan on the Virginia Peninsula. A year after the Civil War started, Arthur decided to end his services and move on. The Union Army had promised him $160 for his work. However, when he was to leave, the quartermaster informed him that they could not pay him that amount. Instead, they could only pay him $40. The Army coerced him into signing an agreement that he would accept $40 as payment. Arthur described his experience as follows, quote, "They took hold of my hand and held it while I made an X to something," unquote. Frustrated, Arthur traveled to Boston, where he could settle and live with other former slaves. In an article written several decades later, Arthur stated that he promised himself that he, quote, "would never make an X again beside my name written by somebody else, and I have kept that word. I have learned to write," unquote. When Arthur arrived in Boston, he found relief and refuge on a property owned by Nathaniel Topliff Allen. Nathaniel let Arthur sleep in the barn and do chores to earn his keep. Though Nathaniel faced scrutiny from the community for taking in former slaves, his property was never destroyed, unlike some of his neighbors. Nathaniel championed for Arthur and wanted to help him become a free man who could contribute to the country's well-being. Thus, in 1863, Nathaniel advocated for Arthur to vote in the United States election, which he did. Nathaniel, the property owner, was a brilliant individual who believed that everyone should receive a public education. Less than 10 years before meeting Arthur and letting him stay on his property, Nathaniel started a school called the West Newton English and Classical School. If the name does not sound familiar, Rebecca Davis Lee attended the same school back in 1852, before she entered medical school. Possibly Nathaniel introduced Arthur to Rebecca. Thus, on May 24, 1865, a year after Rebecca graduated, she and Arthur married. Then Rebecca set up a medical practice in Boston to provide medical services to underprivileged women and their children. However, this was not enough. Rebecca wanted to have a more significant impact on more impoverished areas. So, she and Arthur moved to Richmond, Virginia. She believed that Richmond would be, quote, "a proper field for real missionary work, and one that would present ample opportunities to become acquainted with the diseases of women and children," unquote. In Richmond, she worked for the Bureau of Refugees, Freedmen, and Abandoned Lands, also known as the Freedmen's Bureau. This government agency provided clothing, fuel, shelter, services to refugees, former slaves, their wives, and their children. Rebecca stated, quote, "During my stay there, nearly every hour was improved in that sphere of labor. The last quarter of the year 1866, I was enabled to have access each day to a very large number of the indigent and others of different classes and a population of over 30,000 colored," unquote. Rebecca was accomplishing her goal of having a reach over more people. The patients that Rebecca saw had been denied care by white physicians. In addition, even though she was a respected medical doctor, she was still subjected to racism from the administration and other physicians. She had challenges trying to get prescriptions filled and was often ignored by male physicians. Additionally, many people taunted her, stating that the MD behind her name stood for mule driver. Nevertheless, her desire to serve a charitable role in medicine inspired her to persevere. She stayed in Richmond for 3 more years. In 1869, she and Arthur moved back to Boston, where she felt she would be more welcome. Rebecca and Arthur moved to 67 Joy Street in Boston. Rebecca stated, quote, "I returned to my former home, Boston, where I entered into the work with renewed vigor, practicing outside and receiving children in the home for treatment, regardless in a measure of remuneration," unquote. In other words, she had no intention to receive payment for her services. In 1880, she and Arthur moved to Hyde Park, Massachusetts, where she stopped practicing medicine. She wrote a book titled A Book of Medical Discourses in Two Parts. The first part of the book provided information that explained causes and ways to prevent stomach and bowel infections in children from infancy to 5 years old. The second part of the book contains, quote, miscellaneous information concerning the life and growth of beings, the beginning of womanhood, also the cause, prevention, and cure of many of the most distressing complaints of women, and use of both sexes, unquote. Rebecca had written a thorough book that served as the perfect resources for new mothers. It was, in a way, the precursor to the most infamous book that every mother in the United States is familiar with, called What to Expect When You Are Expecting. For many of us moms, What to Expect When You Are Expecting was our Bible. We have Dr. Rebecca Davis-Lee Crumpler to thank for that. Rebecca and Arthur remained in Hyde Park and became devout members of the 12th Baptist Church on Phillips Street. Arthur was so inspired by his brilliant wife that he went back to school and became determined to read and write and serve the community as much as she helped the community. As a result, he served on the board of trustees for the church. They had a successful marriage that represented the resilience that they both endured before they met. On March 9th, 1895, Rebecca Crumpler passed away battling fibroid tumors. Arthur outlived his wife by 15 years. He passed away in May 1910. They committed so much to the community, to the church, and to the well-being of the marginalized. However, they were buried in graves that were unmarked for 125 years. On July 16th, 2020, Vicki Gall, the president of the Friends of the Hyde Park Branch Library, spearheaded a countrywide fundraiser to erect two gravestones in honor of Rebecca and her husband, Arthur. Rebecca and Arthur lived a life of determination. For Arthur, he sought a better life and found freedom, civil rights, and true love. For Rebecca, she fought the stereotypes and found success as an altruistic medical doctor who healed not just hundreds of former slaves, but thousands of them. Arthur served the community. He empowered his wife, and he was inspired by his wife. And Arthur served the community. He empowered his wife, he was inspired by his wife, and he was determined to become educated. He is an inspiration to the Black men in this country who matter, whose voices matter, whose contributions matter, and whose lives matter. Rebecca served the poor. She helped the underrepresented, and altruistically took care of the marginalized and oppressed. She addressed health inequities among people of color. She started a trail of success that, over time, became a paved road for Black women in medicine. Rebecca Crumpler created that path, and Arthur was there for Rebecca every step of the way. Together, they persevered. Together, Rebecca and Arthur created a partnership that allowed Rebecca to achieve what no other African-American woman in her time had the opportunity to do, which was serve as an inspiration for so many other Black women in medicine. Their love for each other empowered them both to make a difference in the world. Arthur's life story serves as a reminder that Black lives matter, that Black men matter. And through all the women that Rebecca inspired, her legacy forged a highway of success and achievement for all Black women in medicine. Thank you for joining me at Math Science History. Please remember to subscribe to the show. Also, if you could leave a rating or review, it would be so appreciated. Those ratings and reviews really help to increase my listenership, which helped me to get more sponsors, which helped me to keep the podcast up and running. If you want to learn more about the history of math and science, please visit me at mathsciencehistory.com. And if you like what you're listening to, please feel free to click on that cup of coffee image and buy me a cup of coffee, or two, or three, or four, because every cup of coffee that you buy helps me to pay for the expenses that go into making this podcast. Also, if you're interested in leaving me a comment or chatting with me, you can always find me on your preferred social media platform, including Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, and Goodreads. Just search for Gabrielle Burchak. Until next time, carpe diem!